And welcome back to Microsoft Virtual Academy. I'm Brandon Matherson, and I'm a product marketing manager on the Windows Server, System Center, and Azure Data Center Solutions team within Microsoft, helping customers to better deliver services to their business units or their end customers in certain scenarios and across multiple different clouds if they so choose. So we've been talking about automation and self-service thus far, using Service Manager and Orchestrator to better deliver that service in an automated fashion and building out the richness of a service catalog and a standardized set of offerings that we want to deliver in a seamless fashion. So moving forward, let's think about the concept of process automation. Using processes built on our ITIL methodologies to be able to deliver that service and build that into how our components are going to execute on those tasks and those processes that are going to occur. So one of the things that we want to first answer is, what is the process automation and why does this matter? Why is this important? First off, process automation is all about the requests, the approvals, and the fulfillments of processes. Then taking that richness that we've built into the CMDB or the configuration management database, where we've thought about what is our incident processes, our change processes, our release processes, or even our SLAs, because that's important. IT is measured by how quickly we deliver the services to meet the needs of our end users or our business units. So we're going to take advantage of those automated processes and build that into Orchestrator via runbooks. And the runbooks are going to provide a way for those resources to be provisioned the same way every time. That repeatable fashion is critical and is key for IT to become more efficient. We want those processes to enable requests and provisioning through self-service. Self-service is how our end users feel empowered to ask IT for the necessary services and know that they'll be delivered on time and they'll be to their specs or their requirements. We want to take advantage of the CMDB information and identify where we may have systemic issues or problems within the environment as well. So that's something that we want to pay attention to. So one of the things we want to do is first and foremost is select the tasks that we want to automate. And why do we want to automate them? Why is it important? What are the challenges that we're seeing? Which processes are the most time consuming? Start there. That's where I will be able to think about where is my staff spending time doing the same thing over and over again, where I can best use their expertise elsewhere. What are the service levels that are suffering the most? Where am I not meeting my SLAs because I may be introducing some errors, or I may be spending more time than I need to provision a resource because I need to manually go through a number of different systems. Which problems seem to happen the most? That's a big one. The things that are happening all the time, I want to capture that information. I want to identify a fix for that information and apply that same fix every time it occurs so that now I can take advantage of those repeatable tasks and reduce errors and reduce time and increase my productivity for my end users. I want to understand which are the most expensive solutions or expensive services for my enterprise that I'm delivering back to the business. I want to identify what those are so that I can reduce the time and get a better ROI on those particular investments. I then want to understand which failures, which processes are failing the most that are visible to my end users. Errors that are visible to end users can cause significant problems in perception upon how IT delivers services, and it builds confidence and excitement for end users to be able to depend on IT more effectively. So let's look at a basic architecture for what service delivery and automation looks like across the enterprise. And this is how we envision this process occurring. You'll notice we think about release management, change management, a self-service experience, reporting and insights, and that's something that we'll dig into a lot more within the IT service management session that we have as a capability within System Center, and then the incident management piece. So we see the process automation, and that's where we're taking advantage of our service catalog and our workflows, bringing that together, putting that into the and taking advantage of that within the CMDB in terms of work items and configuration items and that knowledge base. We then want to take advantage of the templates that we've built to be able to deliver that service. And that template applies to the request offerings or the service offerings that we've seen within the environment. Then we have our data warehousing, which is basically the data warehouse or the database itself for how we store this information and call upon it as we need to when we think about reporting and insights. This is, can all be done within the orchestrator automation component in this orchestrator level. Integration is where I now think about, how do I start to bring in activities that I do in other systems? Not just service manager, not just orchestrator, but the rest of the system center suite. Pre-configured or pre-defined steps in virtual machine manager, building out or provisioning the infrastructure. Steps that I want to do in terms of monitoring. Where am I getting my monitoring data, and where do I need to identify when alerts are thrown? Using Ops Manager. I want to think about Data Protection Manager. I want to think about Active Directory and the information that I'm getting from Windows Server. And then, of course, we understand that there are mixed environments out there that may take advantage of third-party tools. And we may see, think about, what are we doing with HP, or you may use BMC in your environment. We want you to take advantage of those assets that you've already invested in and use them within this architecture here to take advantage of an automated experience to deliver those services. So process automation is all about simplifying data center management. That's the primary thing that we want to do. We want to standardize those processes. We want to optimize and extend those existing investments. We want to deliver a flexible and reliable services. And then we want to make sure we lower costs and improve predictability. It's all about knowing exactly what is going to be delivered, how it's going to be delivered, and when it's going to be delivered. Those processes are all sitting within the CMDB and within Service Manager. That integration piece is all about taking Orchestrator and optimizing a heterogeneous environments with integration packs or extensibility and using PowerShell when integration packs may not meet the needs. And then the orchestration in terms of plugging together all of those workflows in a way that we can now take advantage of that information. Processes, integration, orchestration leads to automation solution that reduce costs and reduce errors. Now let's think about why is CMDB so important? That's something that we may not have touched on as much, but this is where that is considered the CMDB, or Service Manager is considered the CMDB of the environment, and that's where those policies and those standardized processes can resonate or surface in terms of templates. And I'm bringing together all the request offerings and service offerings and using the templates to do so. Because the runbooks is where I'm getting data about the infrastructure or the people and the process as a key enabler for automation. The templates are where I'm standardizing that information, and I can reduce mistakes. I don't want to see these errors occur time and time again, or introduce more lead time into the environment, because I need to pull together that information that my templates can easily do for me. I let the templates kick off that process and apply the necessary information on the back end. I then use user information out of the CMDB as well. Role-based information is key, because I want to have a full set of offerings, a full set of solutions for customers, but I want to make sure that I can break out what is important for each team. No two teams may operate entirely the same way. So I want to make sure that I'm using role-based access to identify who can see which offerings, who can get access to which processes when they want to kick off certain requests, because all your end users are going to do is request a service. They don't necessarily need to see the runbooks or see the automated tasks on the back end. That's what IT defines in terms of how do I get that service in their hands. So ultimately, a CMDB information is used by Orchestrator, because Orchestrator can then bring in those connectors and the information into Service Manager and tell it exactly when and where to go. Now, staying aware through notifications is also a big one, because I need to understand when there's some issues that are occurring, and I'm going to take advantage of some of my ITSM ideas in terms of incident management, change management, and managing those processes. So let's say incident management. I want to be able to detect when an error has occurred, and I want to record that information and apply a process to resolve that. So I'm going to use some forms, I'm going to use templates, and I'm going to use incidents through email. kicking that information from orchestrator over to service manager to get that information completed. I then want to classify what type of issue has occurred. Am I reaching a threshold in terms of capacity? Or do I have an outage or is a server down? I'm able to kick that information over to service manager as well, and I can use an incident workflow to be able to do so. And I can use information from ops manager to be able to do that, or configuration manager if I need to actually change some parameters within the environment. Now, I then need to update that incident, and I need to reroute that process and kick that back off for a prioritization, because priorities are key in terms of understanding when I need to actually attend to a given issue that has occurred. So once I know all of these steps, you'll notice there's a set of steps that I can walk through here. When an incident comes in, I detect and record it. I classify that incident. I investigate and diagnose that incident. Let's say it's occurred time and time again. I can apply my previous learnings to that to resolve that. I resolve it and I recover. And that's when I'm able to make sure that resource, or that, let's say, a VM is back up and running. I've resolved any capacity issues or storage issues, and now I can provide that VM back to my end users without them seeing little to no downtime. And that's the process that we'll follow when we use incidents to manage the sustainability of our environment. Now, why is this important? What can this do? Let's add some real-time parameters to this in terms of what you may see in your environment. For instance, you want to automate a step that you perform day in and day out, something you do every day. There's an alert that's thrown before service manager, before orchestrator, or even before system center. You may not have anything in your environment. You're using someone on your staff to actually manually go check on this alert, go fix it, and go resolve it. This can take a number of minutes each day of someone's time to be able to do that. As I'm seeing here, this may take upwards to 15 to 20 minutes to be able to do this. And it can take me a week to build out a runbook to do this. So now I can compare the time that it takes me to actually build this runbook versus the time it takes for me to actually do this day in and day out over every day of the year. 120 hours versus 40 hours to build out this automated process is a win-win and a value add for using Orchestrator to create a runbook and automate a process that occurs all the time. You've been able to save time of reduced time for this being resolved. That's a great point for where you can start to show return on investment back to the enterprise, back to your senior decision makers in terms of why this matters in terms of automating processes. Now, predictable service delivery is another important piece. That's all about how do we actually deliver that service in a predictable manner. So I want to take a look at a couple of runbooks that helps us be able to remediate any alerts. Let's say in this case, we have some alerts that are coming in. We want to remediate the problems that may be showing up in the environment. And again, I want to expand some capacity. I've had an alert where, let's say, I had a VM or I had some resources and I'm getting to maximum capacity on that. So I know that this VM is close to being fully consumed and my users are going to see an error. My users may not have seen the error yet, but Operations Manager has been very helpful in getting me this information, and connecting the dots between Orchestrator and Ops Manager has helped me do that. So I want to make sure that I want to await new free space issues and scale storage appropriately. So here's a runbook where I want to monitor for free space alert, and I built out a runbook to be able to do that. And I want to know and check where do I see an error, a potential error that has not caused downtime yet. So I want to check and delete a file, and then I want to get some disk space status so that I can dynamically reach for affected machine and the disks that are going to be consumed here. So this runbook checks for that, and that's what we're showing right now, that we're checking for where we are in terms of a status of that threshold. I then identify that, yes, I do have some low disk space, so I want to try to resolve that issue, and if not, I want to kick off a trouble ticket. That trouble ticket can then get put into Service Manager, where I want to create an incident so that Service Manager knows to go kick off some next steps to be able to go resolve that issue. So I've detected that, and I want to go secure a channel issue or secure or start a server. Here's another scenario where I want to do that. I want to detect an issue and I want to repair it. So I built a runbook to be able to do so. And in this particular case, I'm using some commands to do that. And then I want to restart that server. And if it fails, if that doesn't work, I create an incident. I go into Service Manager, and Service Manager then starts to perform those same tasks as we have before. So instead of an end user already getting to a point of failure and kicking off an alert and they losing productivity in their environment or not being able to do their job, we've now been able to set some thresholds where I monitor for when I'm getting low. Instead of getting to 0%, I said, let me know when I'm at about 20 or 10 or 15% capacity and kick off an alert and automatically resolve that issue. And if that issue doesn't get resolved, let's go ahead and expand capacity and remediate that problem. So that's how we can monitor alerts and use alerts to be able to fix problems. Now, let's look at how we may introduce Orchestrator. Orchestrator in a scenario where I may want to do some patch management tools, or I want to fix some issues with some of my workloads. So I want to think about what can I use here. I want to patch a machine. That's essentially what I want to do. And I have a runbook here that calls Configuration Manager for patching activities that I want to perform. So what does this runbook look like? It's a lot of steps here that I want to go through of identifying that runbook and then going through remediating those steps. And I want to check the machine for a specific patch. I need to know, do I have the appropriate patch for this given machine? Has it been resolved? Am I up to date in terms of being compliant? I could have support issues if I'm not. I can have performance issues if I'm not. So I want to do some consistent queries within my environment to check for the critical workloads that I have in my environment that are up to date, and I want to take the next step to patch them. I then want to check services are fine after patching. I've taken those steps. I've patched. Is my service still performing appropriately? Is my VM, is my server, is my resource performing as it should now that I've actually stepped in and provided the patch that I've identified that I was missing? And if so, I've been able to walk through that step. And then the runbook then calls patching sequence in the machine order, right? So what this is saying is that I've been able to identify a runbook that is already sitting inside this one. Again, this is a nested runbook that calls for the patching sequence because sometimes it needs to happen in a specific order. Let's say if I have an environment that is configured, some proprietary software, some third-party software that is spread across a number of different VMs, I have a process in order to patch these machines. This runbook calls for that process and does it appropriately. So then I want to verify patching and execute changes if that needs to occur. And here's another runbook that I've brought into the scenario here where I want to patch SQL and I want to ensure that it has taken the appropriate effects. I want to apply the change request if this build is not done appropriately, if this has not been met as required, and this runbook runs through that process to do so. I then want to evaluate the parameters of the databases hosted on that server, right? I need to make sure that these databases are up and running, that they're at the optimal configuration, that I have not introduced any downtime or any error or performance issues into the environment or into the database once I've been able to perform those steps. So that's how we think about orchestrating workload maintenance. I thought about patching a machine, and then you think about how do I patch SQL, or where it's dependent, where other users are dependent upon its performance as they deliver tasks. And this is Orchestrator doing a lot of these maintenance tasks solely within the environment. I can also think about bringing in Orchestrator to do the same thing. So this is how we can think about deploying these services and applying processes to automate those steps or those tasks. So this has been a great tool that you can leverage within your environment, and we want to encourage you to download download System Center 2012 R2 and get your hands on it and try Service Manager, try Orchestrator, and learn how it works and apply some of these ideas to it. You can take it a step further and try the TechNet Virtual Labs as well, and go in there and play with some unique scenarios that we've built and we've walked through that you can then play with and learn how to do the step-by-step process on your own within your environment. And lastly, we encourage you to continue to come back to Microsoft Virtual Academy and learn more about automation and self-service, System Center 2012 R2, and a number of the capabilities that we're delivering in our current release. Thank you, and my name is Brandon Matherson.